Hello and welcome to True Crime in Science, our new show that discusses real-life cases but delves further into the forensic details behind them. I'm your host, Chris Carpinetti.
And I'm Eleanor Higgs, and today we're going to look at the Capital Gazette mass shooting and how facial recognition technology was used to identify the killer.
The Capital Gazette, also known as The Capital, was founded in 1884. It is a daily newspaper published by Capital Gazette Communications in Annapolis, Maryland, USA. In 2011, writer Eric Thomas Hartley, who worked for The Capital, published a story about a man named Jarrod W. Ramos. They ran an accurate article reporting on Ramos's troubling behavior, which involved using Facebook to stalk and harass a woman he knew from high school. This went on for over a year.
The woman reportedly didn't recall Jarrod and asked him to send pictures so she could try to remember him. A quote from her in Hartley's article reads, "I just thought I was being friendly, but when it seemed to me that it was turning into something that gave me a bad feeling in the pit of my stomach, that he seems to think there's some sort of relationship here that doesn't exist, I tried to slowly back away from it, and he just started getting angry and vulgar to the point I had to tell him to stop." The woman said she had later been put on probation at the bank where she worked, and said that she was told by a supervisor that Ramos had called and advised the bank to fire her. She believed that Ramos had played a part in the loss of her job, though she could not prove it.
Ramos pleaded guilty to harassment, yet when the Capital ran a story on him, he accused them of defamation and sued them. During the case, Ramos posted several tweets criticizing the paper and the writer of the article, Eric Thomas Hartley. In 2014, Hartley left the Capital Gazette and Ramos tweeted, "Yes, Eric Thomas Hartley, you moved. Oh, just go ahead and kill yourself already before I do," he added in parentheses, "legally, in court." An archived version of a website under Ramos's name featured court documents and messages. One message, titled Open Season, listed the address of Capital Gazette Communications, the home of the newspaper. It stated, "They call themselves an important watchdog, but who watches the watchers? Even kings must answer to God, and a modern-day inquisition is at hand. The potential judgment is no less severe. The carnage differs only in literal terms." The lawsuit was dismissed in 2015.
On June 28, 2018, a man turned up at the offices of the Capital Gazette. He wielded a shotgun, which had been bought legally 18 months prior, and was armed with grenades and flashbang devices. The man barricaded the rear exit to prevent anyone escaping, then shot through the glass door and fired into the newsroom. A reporter, Wendy Winters, charged him with a recycling bin and distracted him long enough for others to escape or take shelter, before Ramos shot and killed her. He killed four other members of staff and critically wounded two others. When the police arrived, they found the shooter under a desk in the office, yet at the time, his identity was elusive.
Reports suggested the shooter did everything he could to avoid being named. He had no identification on him, and there were even reports that he had filed his fingerprints to prevent identification. But police have since backed away from this claim, saying that it was only his initial fingerprint identification that had failed. With no fingerprints and the perpetrator refusing to cooperate, police had to consider other ways to identify the shooter. They sent images of the man to the Maryland Coordination and Analysis Center and compared it against other images in the Maryland Image Repository System, also known as MIRS, which has over 10 million photos of known offenders as well as driver's license photos. The system also accesses the FBI's mugshot database, which adds a further 25 million faces to search through. Due to Jarrod Ramos's previous convictions, his picture was likely to have been on the database and they were ultimately able to confirm him as the shooter.
On July 20, 2018, Jarrod W. Ramos was indicted on 5 counts of first-degree murder, 1 count of attempted first-degree murder, 6 counts of first-degree assault, and 11 counts of the use of a firearm in the commission of a felony. He pleaded not guilty to all charges. A forensic psychiatrist testified that Ramos suffered a severe narcissistic injury from the Capital Gazette article about his harassment allegations, and was motivated by a fixation on revenge. That Ramos had expressed regret that he'd been unable to kill everyone in the newsroom, and the state's attorney, and that Ramos had carefully planned the attack on the newspaper's office after determining that a courthouse, his initial target, was too secure. In July 2021, the jury found Ramos criminally responsible, rejecting Ramos's insanity defense and determining that he committed the killings while mentally competent and capable of conforming his actions to the law. On September 28, 2021, Ramos was sentenced to 5 life terms plus 345 years in prison.
The Capital Gazette shooting was a tragedy and horrific to all involved. When asked about Ramos's motives, his aunt expressed disbelief over the attack and described her nephew as a very intelligent but a loner who wasn't close to anybody. Ramos stated he had seen 5 mental health professionals for at least 75 visits before the shooting and exhibited a pattern of threats. Many of those around Ramos said he was a calculated, manipulative loner who would become angry when things did not go his way. Some were convinced that he would one day hurt someone. The day of the incident was made more difficult when the police struggled to identify the man they had in custody through traditional forensic techniques, but thankfully the digital technique of facial recognition was employed and used to match Jarrod Ramos to the shooter.
Facial recognition software is what allows a smartphone user to unlock their phone by simply pointing a camera at themselves. It has also been tested by some police departments that are seeking to quickly match names or images of suspects against their database of arrested individuals. The Maryland Police Chief, Timothy Altomare, endorsed the use of software in this case, saying, "We would have had much longer in identifying him and being able to push forward in this investigation without that system. It was a huge win for us last night, and thus the citizens of Anne Arundel County." We will now break down exactly how facial recognition software works and where it is employed.
Facial recognition identifies or confirms an individual's identity using their face. It is a category of biometric security. Other forms of biometric software include eye retina or iris recognition, fingerprint recognition, or voice recognition. Facial recognition uses technology and biometrics, typically through AI, to identify human faces. It uses the software to map the similarity between 2 face images from a video or photograph and then compares that information with a database of known faces in order to evaluate a match. Technology systems can vary, but in general, there is a rough guideline. The camera will detect the image of a face, either alone or in a crowd. The image may show the person looking straight ahead or to the side. Facial recognition usually uses 2D images. The software will first scan videos and images to create a map of a person's facial features called facial signature. The technology will read the geometry of the face and match them to people via other 2D photographs in the public database. The main attributes of the face which it can read include the depth of eye sockets, the distance from your forehead to your chin, scarring, contour of people's lips, the shape of your cheekbones, as well as many more minor increments included in facial detail. These images will then be generated as mathematical codes, which are then compared to each other to detect similarities. These codes are known as face prints, and they work in a similar way to thumbprints, in that every person has a print unique to themselves. Face prints are compared to an array of other known faces, which are stored on vast databases. The FBI, for example, has access to 650 million photos. On Facebook, tagged photos can also be used by facial recognition technologies.
Airports use face recognition to implement biometric passports to skip waiting times, as well as to identify people who may be under criminal investigation. Retail outlets use it to improve and make personalized suggestions for their customers and to catch shoplifters. Banks use it to authorize transactions. Media companies also use facial recognition to test audience reaction to movie trailers and characters in TV pilots.
Healthcare providers are testing the use of facial recognition to access patient records, streamline patient registration, detect emotion and pain in patients, and even help to identify specific genetic diseases.
But of course, a top benefit is that it is being used to catch and/or deter criminals. Many people are familiar with face recognition technology when they use it to unlock smartphones. However, this is only one application of face recognition. Typically, facial recognition simply identifies and recognizes one person as the sole owner of the device, while limiting access to others. Beyond unlocking phones, facial recognition works by matching the faces of people walking past special cameras to images of people on watch lists. The watch list can contain pictures of anyone, including people who are not suspected of any crime, and the images can come from anywhere, even from our social media accounts.
Facial recognition technology can inspire intense reactions from others. While useful in a lot of cases, certain people, such as employees from tech companies as well as civil rights activists, have argued that the system has to see limitations. There is concern from people that the use of facial recognition, video cameras, and AI could create a world where mass surveillance becomes an issue. There is also concern for error within the software. A change in camera angle or personal appearance has been known to identify people incorrectly. There are also worries about privacy, in that certain governments are storing citizen photographs without their knowledge or consent. In 2020, the European Commission said it was going to consider a ban on facial recognition in public spaces for up to 5 years, so that it could work out a better regulatory framework to deter privacy and ethical abuse of the technology. It is known that facial recognition is less effective in identifying people of colour and women. Studies show that the error rate of light-skinned men is 0.8%, compared to 34.7% for darker-skinned women. With law enforcement and the criminal justice system already disproportionately targeting people of colour, facial recognition technology with documented problems identifying people of colour could be dangerous.
In the case of the Capital Gazette shooting, facial recognition was pivotal in identifying the perpetrator in a timely manner. However, when it comes to facial recognition technology, it is clearly an immensely useful and powerful tool that we have come to implement in our lives on a daily basis, but there's also clearly room for improvement.
Facial recognition is used to aid human decision-making, not replace it. Human oversight mitigates the risk of errors. Operators need to enforce conditions in order to put in place the right safeguards to manage trade-offs between accuracy and risk. A better understanding of these issues will help ensure this technology can be deployed safely in ways that let us capture its benefits while managing risks. Ethical concerns arise when the human element is removed from AI, as machines lack an understanding of the complexities of humans. Thank you for watching True Crime in Science. Please subscribe for more content like this.